Yeah, thanks for the invitation to talk. I'll describe a little bit of work we've been doing with my group the last 2-3 years on population control in the sense of telling people what to do. If you were at CPS week last year, you may have seen most of the slides, so feel free to go to sleep and then wake up in about 15 minutes when I'm done. The session is titled Hybrid Systems, so I felt obliged to say something about hybrid systems, but I haven't done very much on hybrid systems recently. So I'll give you a view from the good old days back in the 90s, where we draw pictures like this and explain, for example, why multi-agent systems that, you know, Pravin's PATH project, automated highway systems, had this feature that combined discrete and continuous dynamics. So coordination, communication among the agents, together with motion of the agents, gave rise to these hybrid systems. Back then, there wasn't PowerPoint, but if there was, we would do animations like this. We sort of explain that this brings together the computer science world that we heard about this morning from Richard, together with differential equations and also trajectories and things like this, making sort of hybrid systems in the middle. So that's sort of my hybrid systems two slides, or one plus animation. The other thing that these systems, though, have in common is they're all sort of large-scale, big systems that comprise many components, and each one of the components has decision-making of its own. So there's local decision-making that is driven sort of at a higher level by some global constraints, which, for example, imply that the well-being of the agents is not depending only on their own decision, but also on the decisions that everyone else makes. So they're coupled through their decisions. Okay. Now, for systems of this size, it's often impractical to do control at a centralized level where you tell every individual person what they're supposed to be doing. Maybe you can't do it because of constraints, or maybe you don't want to do it because people don't want to listen to you. So there's work, sort of game theory type work, which is the perspective I will take, which is how do you get the right emergent behavior from providing information to these individual agents. So you don't tell them what to do, but you sort of give them information and let them make the decisions, and you just give them the information in a way that makes them, as an aggregate, do what you would like. And in control context, this is sort of a game theory. It's been going on for quite a few years, this type of aggregated games. The mean-field games have come to prominence recently with the work of Peter Keynes and Lyon in the control. In the stochastic context, I'll be talking about the deterministic context here. So basically, the idea is to provide information and try to steal them so that the macroscopic behavior is good. And there's a number of systems that have this type of characteristic. We've looked quite a bit at demand-response schemes, for example, in energy systems, for example, thermostatically controlled loads, like here refrigerators and water heaters and so on, where you communicate with them not individually but through an aggregator. You give them price information, you let them do their thing, and then hopefully at the aggregate level you get something useful. Same thing for plug-in electric vehicles, actually a very Berkeley thing. Danka Callaway has worked on both of these problems. We collaborated actually for a while. Biology systems, we look at population control using light, so shining light at cells and trying to get them to do something useful altogether. But there are other people who do this with microfluidic devices, adding chemicals and so on. And this is the same pattern appears in transportation, crowd control, and so on. So in my lab, we've looked at a few problems like this: demand response in for residential loads, traffic, biology, plug-in electric vehicles. I'll just talk about plug-in electric vehicles, and this is some, you know, references to things we've published recently on the other areas. And this is actually a problem that's been looked at here in Berkeley as well by Duncan Calloway. This is the problem of if you have a population of plug-in electric vehicles, each one has its own constraints and requirements. They want to be charged by a certain time. They want to be charged as fast as possible. They have certain limits on how much charge they can accept at any point in time, and so on and so forth. They're very heterogeneous. Everyone has a different one. And you will need to coordinate them. You need to coordinate them because at the global level, this is sort of the someone who cares about how much the aggregate demand is for all of the vehicles. So this is, let's say, a transmission system operator that sees this demand valley. This is a non-PEV demand during the day, midnight to midnight. And then you see in the middle of the night is basically not much happening, so you have a gap there. You would like to, if you have now plug-in electric vehicle demand, make sure that it happens somewhere over here so you don't have to use more generation capacity at the times when you already have demand. So you'd like to put the take the PEV demand and put it all in there. If you let them do their thing, you won't get this. You get some, you know, random pattern where they all come home and plug in and charge, and most of it will be happening during times when you already have very high demand, and that's undesirable. So you'd like to somehow tell them, look, do this, but without telling individuals, you do this, you do this, you do this. Okay? This is the model of Callaway of this. Now you say, okay, I have a total charge I want to take. U is the charge at any point in time. So over the horizon, I want to take this total charge. And what am I going to pay for it? There's a price of electricity times the charge I'm taking at any point in time. So that's, you think of them as vectors, indexed by the horizon, a la model predictive control. And the price depends on whatever everyone else is doing. So Z is the aggregate variable, is the total demand of everyone else. And when there's high demand, the price is high. When there's low demand, the price is low. Now, Callaway also adds these terms here. Callaway, Hiskins, in their paper, they add this term, a regularizer, to make sure that things settle down. And I'll show in a minute that this has some, you know, algorithmic effect. But it's a bit of an arbitrary thing that you put there, to put a quadratic regularizer. Okay. Now, each agent takes this information from the aggregate and computes the optimal response. And that leads to a new aggregate. And they new prices, new optimal response, new aggregate, new price, new optimal response. The question is, will this ever converge? A bit more abstractly, this is now an optimization problem. More generally, you have every agent making a decision, and the decision depends on the aggregate. The aggregate here is the average of the consumption of everyone else at any point in time. You can put weights for them. For example, in the examples we do with opinion dynamics, some people's word carries more weight, so you put a higher coefficient there. But you can think of this as sort of a linear combination of everyone else here with equal weights. Okay. So you're called upon as an agent I to make a decision that depends on the aggregate. And you have your individual constraints. And here you can put your dynamic constraints, like the charging of the battery, what is the state of charge, or more general, you know, linear constraints or whatever, plus bounds on inputs, bounds on states, and whatever else you want to put. So this is the optimization problem that every agent is solving. Okay. The centralized operator provides information. So it takes the solutions of these individual agents and computes the aggregate and then tells them something about the aggregate to help them make the next decision. The point is that you don't have to tell them exactly what the aggregate is, though. You can tell them something that's related to the aggregate to help them make the right decision, but you don't have to tell them really the aggregate. So the question is, if you tell them this information, what will they do? This is how they will respond if you tell them information that's related to the aggregate in some sense. So they will compute their optimal solution. And then you will take these solutions and aggregate them and get a new aggregate solution. So, okay, some technical conditions just to for the whole thing to make sense. Not absolutely strictly necessary, but usually you assume some convex quadratic costs with a linear term. And then there's the question of, you know, what do you put there for Q and delta? What will happen? And generally, you have heterogeneous compact constraints, convex on X. And now what you want to do, you want to design a scheme to help them coordinate. So you, the question is, this is your controller now. This is what you will tell them at time k plus 1. When you make that a function of what you told them at time k plus the aggregate that came out. And then you give them this new information and ask them to compute the solution again. So it's like a control scheme like this. This is now an iteration space. They have some information, compute an optimal solution. You perform the aggregation and you decide, what do I tell them now? This is what I told them last time. This is what happened. What should I tell them now to get them to move one step further and get closer to what I want them to do? So that's a scheme. That's an iteration scheme. It's a feedback loop. And question is, what will happen? Will this algorithm converge? How should you select this feedback map phi that tells them the new information so that you get it to converge? What are they going to converge to? What are the properties of this point? And what is the, now if you see it as a game between them, what are the game theoretic properties of the individual responses now to this optimal signal? First one is easy. Convergence of the algorithm is basically getting a fixed point of something. Fixed point of, in this case, the aggregation map. So this aggregation map is a fixed point of the map, is a global information such that if you give it to the players and they respond optimally, you aggregate the solution, you get back to the global information you gave them. So it's a fixed map of this aggregation, it's a fixed point of this aggregation map. So now the question is, what properties of my feedback calculation, the information I give them, guarantee that I converge to a fixed point, and this has to do with regularity properties of the aggregation map. And this is, then you use fixed point theorem to get this. And this is examples of situations where you can get convergence. This is my quadratic cost, and it all has to do with basically the properties of the quadratic cost. Bunch of conditions, so SDP type conditions, linear matrix inequality conditions on the constants that you have there to get different kind of regularity properties, contractive, fermion expansive, non-expansive, strictly pseudo-contractive, these are operator theoretic properties that ensure that certain operations, iterations in the literature, Picard-Banach, Krasnoselsky iteration, Mann iteration, and so on, converge to a fixed point. And you see this get progressively weaker and weaker conditions, and correspondingly the iterations get weaker and weaker in terms of, for example, how long it takes to converge. This converges exponentially, whereas the others you don't know. They can converge very slowly. And finally, game theory. What is the properties of this fixed point? It turns out that the fixed point is actually a Nash equilibrium. It's almost a Nash equilibrium. You look at the responses that you get at the fixed point, and it turns out that the regret that you have is almost a Nash in the sense that you're epsilon away from a Nash equilibrium. The regret that you have is no more than if you change your policy, you won't gain more than epsilon n, where epsilon n actually depends on the size of the population, goes down linearly in the size of the population. So a bigger population means everyone is happier with the final solution. How does it work for the plug-in electric vehicle example? This is a simulation with a few thousand plug-in electric vehicles. And this is showing that this arbitrary constant delta has an effect. If you were to do what Duncan Calloway was doing, you do Picard-Banach iteration, you need delta to be within a very tight range to get convergence. If you're outside this range, you make delta smaller, for example. If you get the Picard-Banach iteration, you get a trajectory that looks like this, which is by no means, I wanted it to be flat. It's by no means flat. It's going up and down during the day, during the evening. Whereas if you do the weaker type of iteration, the Mann iteration, you actually get convergence to the optimal solution, the valley filling solution. And the reason for this is actually lack of convergence. This is from the previous simulation. What happens if you do the Picard-Banach iteration? You see nothing happens. You just jump between two different trajectories without convergence. Whereas if you do the more slower but converging Mann iteration, you get down to the optimal solution. And this also relates how big this parameter is. This is the delta, the relaxation term you put. Relates on how happy you are with the final solution. This is a regret, percent regret. This is epsilon, how far away you are from the Nash equilibrium, as a function of delta. And you see it goes down quite rapidly the smaller and smaller you make delta. So you can get closer to a Nash equilibrium by making this delta small, which can be useful. OK. That's more or less it. I just talked very briefly and just gave the simplest type of condition that you can get here. But in the meantime, we have sort of all sorts of different results along these lines. So for example, this was just individual agents. They have their own constraints and a global cost coupling them. You can have coupling constraints among the agents. In the plug-in electric vehicle example is substation constraints, where you have a neighborhood that has to feed off the same substation, so the total demand cannot exceed the rating of this substation, and how do you give this information back to the agents. You can have network information structure, where not everyone talks to everyone else. They just exchange information along the network. And then under what conditions will this iteration converge, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we've figured out a number of these different cases. It turns out, actually, I presented it in the operator theoretic context, but the best way to do it is using variational inequalities that actually give you, again, theorems about iterations that converge under much weaker conditions, actually. And all of these can be addressed. The coupling constraints, network information can be addressed in the variational inequality framework. And then we've looked at a number of applications. There's a lot more than this. Energy systems, demand response, and plug-in electric vehicles are two examples that we've looked at. Transportation, which is actually much more difficult, and we're still not quite sure how to go about it. But we also looked, for example, at opinion dynamics in social networks, where you have people exchanging information. The question is, will their opinions converge to something? And even I have this project on treating students like a population and try to give them macroscopic information to get them to converge to a good state of knowledge in a sense, and how do you do sort of this information pitching to them at an individual level. Okay, this is not sort of, this is just the math of it. There's lots of practical things. At the end of the day, you have to align the interests of many stakeholders. So this is a technical, social, and economic system all at once. So it also requires suitable incentive schemes. You know, who would invest in a scheme like this? Where is the money going to come from? What are the business models that can come out of this? Privacy issues and so on and so forth. And these are all topics we're looking at with collaboration with economists, marketing people, who, you know, designing schemes for convincing users to join schemes like this. It turns out there's not a lot of money in it, for example, in demand response, and you have to give them some other type of incentive to get them to join and get them engaged, and we'll look into questions like this. In the end, you know, human in the loop decisions is what Praveen asked yesterday. We model everyone like a rational agent making decisions, but in fact, they're not, so sort of, you know, we need to reconsider how to do this. Okay, I'll finish with couple of comments about Shankar. This is back in the 90s again, and I went back before coming to find pictures of Shankar from the 90s. And to my horror, I couldn't find all that many. I think it's because back then you couldn't take pictures with your cell phone. Actually, back then you didn't even have a cell phone because they weren't available yet, believe it or not. I was only able to track down two. The first one is very predictable. It's Shankar and I in a fancy dress costume party. This is 20 years ago, almost to the day. It was just after we celebrated his 40th birthday in Cafe Venezia, Down University. And the other one is we feature, but we're not the stars of the picture, unfortunately. I didn't find any other. This actually, the star of the picture is John Koo in the middle here. He's a former student of Shankar's who couldn't be here today. This was shot by Bruno Sinopoli down in Cesar. The Cesar is a wine bar. It just opened back then. It was all the rage. Apparently still there. We went last night and still looks pretty much the same. And this is John Koo teaching us how to properly toast in Chinese with both hands, and Shankar and I are trying to learn this. Okay, so I don't have many pictures, but I have all the memories, and I'm very thankful for this, Shankar. So, yeah, happy birthday, and many thanks. Classes, yeah. So this, some of it goes pretty much the same way. For example, you would have leaders, followers, leader-follower type things, and the heterogeneity helps a lot there because everyone could have their own constraints and, in some case, even their own cost functions. So you can make it quite heterogeneous. Unfortunately, you always need to have to get convergence. You need some kind of coupling between their cost functions. So they can't be completely independent. They have to satisfy certain, so the leaders have to have certain properties in the cost function, the followers different properties in the cost function. But you can't do it with different subpopulations as well. No. She has experience about oscillations caused by plugging the link of grid. I'm wondering if it's because it's uncoordinated. It's uncoordinated.
It's uncoordinated.
Yeah. And this is not uncoordinated. This is you give them, this is an iteration that takes place. Someone comes in and you iterate to find a fixed point. Yeah, so the oscillations, actually, I didn't have a picture, but you could see them if you just let them plug in and see what happens, then you get the oscillations. Actually, immediately, you know, you can just start a simulation and see what happens. It's exactly like this. You get a secondary peaks as the, you know, the people show up, plug in their cars, you get secondary peaks and then droughts. And,
okay, other questions? Okay, thank you very much.